Hello, everybody, and welcome to the third and final webinar as part of the May webinar series. And today I'm joined by Hans Vualda of Logigear Corporation, US, and he will be talking to you today about how to get automation testing done. It's a very interesting title, so I'm looking forward to hearing from Hans. And if you'd like to ask him any questions, please type your questions into the control panel there beside you. And at the end of the webinar, we'll go through your questions one by one. And don't forget, you don't have to wait till the very end of the webinar. Just type your questions in as you see fit. So now let me hand you over to today's presenter, Hans Vualda. Hello, Hans.
Hello, Derek. Thanks for having me. I hope everybody can hear me okay. I'm speaking to you from California. It's 8 o'clock in the morning here, so I'm just starting to wake up. And I hope you can see my screen. I'm going to talk to you about automated testing done. So that is it's largely related to Agile, particularly to Scrum. It is a selection of a much larger set of slides that I have. And that means that sometimes it might go leap a little bit over certain topics. I might not be able to go into much detail. So if you have any questions, you can type them in the chat box, or you can use any of these addresses that I'm displaying here to contact me and ask further questions. So who is talking to you today? My name is Hans Boelde. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm in California since 2001, working for a company called Logigear. Logigear is in Foster City, California, that is basically in Silicon Valley. And we're around since 1994. And we do everything about testing, software testing, whether it's UI, whether it's web, whether it's embedded software. That's what we do. We can do consultancy and training. We have a large services organization, about 700 people, that actually develop and automate tests. And we also do some development services, which we always integrate with testing. We have some products. The main ones are Test Architect and Test Architect for Visual Studio. I will not bother you with these products today, but they kind of implement some of the concepts that I will be showing you today, but you're not dependent on those. There is also interesting to note here in the magazine that we maintain about 4 times per year, and those are themed issues. So if you want to know everything that is to know about mobile testing, you just pick up that magazine and there are third-party articles in there talking about that particular topic. Move on. What I will be talking about mostly is functional testing and also some integration testing. What I will not talk about is unit testing. Unit testing, to get automation in unit testing is usually not such a big problem, and so it's not really a topic for today. Let me get my screen a little bit in order. What I will also not talk about today is exploratory testing. That's kind of the opposite end of the spectrum. In exploratory testing, it's really humans working with a system under test, usually very deep and thorough, very good in finding problems, but it's not primarily aimed at automation. So I'm like, we'll be talking about that middle tier, where many of the tests tend to go through the UI, which is not an absolute necessity, but that's quite common. And it can often be a bottleneck in scalability, either within sprints, within teams, or later on for the whole organization. So what makes testing, and especially automated testing, in Agile successful? And this is what I would answer if that question was asked. First of all, a high degree of automation coverage. In the early days, it was nice to have automation. And you could make a decision whether to automate test or not automate test. in the days of Agile, and specifically since DevOps came around, automation is kind of a necessity. And DevOps itself is kind of an automation of the, includes an automation of the release process. And so within that, any test that you want to execute it smartly, and you want to execute it with automation. Now, the good news is that if you are in an Agile project, like Scrum or even Kanban, that you're really well suited to do automation successfully. If you put your mind to it as a team, you will be able to get it done. At least I will give you some direction, some practices to do so. Very important for that is that the QA members in a team, the QA role I should say, stays in the same sprint with the rest of the team. That's something I've noticed and saw in several projects. It becomes a problem if the testers are still working on the previous sprint, because not all the tests were developed, not all the tests were automated yet, not that automation is executing that. And that is a kind of a self-propelling effect. The further you lag behind, the less access you have to product owners and developers, because they already moved on, and the less successful you're going to be. However, it's also not always practical to have the fully automated test sprint. In other words, you don't really want to wait or do less in the test because you can't get your automation done. Sprints are there to develop rapidly, and you don't want to wait too long because some kind of an automated test is still not working. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. And here is that in a picture. And you typically see in sprints that the product owners and the developers move on, go to the next sprint, done, and once that cadence sets in, that tends to be pretty stable. Unfortunately, the QA with the test development and the automation might lag behind, might not yet be done, might still be lingering in that earlier sprint, then of course has less access to the developers and product owners, so lags further behind, you're not in a good spot. And then you obviously teams have to pause, do a hardening sprint or something like that to just to catch up. So here is some of the approaches that I will talk about today. The first step, in my view, the most important step, is the test design. You really must try to design your test, not only to be good tests, which of course is a given, but it also to be automation friendly, to be straightforward to automate. And that's why I make that statement there. Successful automation is not as much a technical challenge as it is a test design challenge. And what that means, we'll see in a moment. That also means tests need to be easy to understand for all involved. And not in every project, everybody is an engineer. You will have domain experts, end users, product owners, management, all kinds of auditors maybe, all kinds of people involved in the project that also need to be able to understand those tests. So I will show you two examples how you can do that. So it should not be too technical. Now I put another note there. Easy to understand does not mean that the tests necessarily are easy. Testing is not always easy, because if testing was easy, the bugs wouldn't be there. A tester needs to be sharp, needs to think outside of the box. So when I say easy, I mean easy to understand, not necessarily easy to create. And then invest in the testability of the system under test. So when you're building an application or a service or anything, make sure it's well testable. And that is also, again, one of the main benefits of having a team, is that you can work with developers to make the test system friendly for automation and for testing in general, but most of all automation. And that works two ways. If you organize your test very well, you design your test very well, and you cooperate closely, you get what is commonly referred to as test-driven development or acceptance test-driven development. The tests themselves give plenty of input for developers and product owners to think about what they are developing, and also what could go wrong with that. And then last but not least, organize it all well, know what you're going to do when in the sprint, and also maybe outside of the sprint, depending on how well ahead you are. We'll talk about that at the end of this talk. Now talk about easy to understand. What you see here is a piece of code which is using Selenium. And Selenium, you probably know, is a well-established tool for testing web applications. And it is a very good tool, very well defined, very well built, very well maintained. However, it's not very readable. So you see just about every company that starts with Selenium get into trouble because the tests are so difficult to understand. Yeah, you can see it here. Just to wait for a web page to be ready, it's a very complicated process. You have to have embedded classes, that you have to create a method for that, and then you have to start waiting for that. So the problem here is not the technology. The technology is wonderful. The problem here is not an easy medium to communicate. So you see all kinds of attempts, including, for example, page objects. You see all kinds of attempts to get away from that technology. So here is one way to do that with keywords, what we always call actions. And what you do here is that you write your test outside of the scripting, and then we do that in a spreadsheet format. And each line is an action. So the first line is open an account, and the account is 123123. The first name is John, the last name is Doe. Then we deposit some money in that account. Then we deposit some more money in that account. And then we check the balance. So when we look at that $30.33 here, what is the balance? That is actually the expected value. You still have to run the test to know whether it is the actual value. Now what you're probably also noticing is that this test is quite easy to understand. It's about an account, we deposit some money, we check a balance. Not so difficult, especially not when you are in banking. However, I have not shown you even the system and the test yet. Could be anything, could be web-based, could be WPF or WinForms, Java, could be an app on a mobile, could be an old-fashioned legacy mainframe system. All of those would be able to listen to these tests. So even though technically this is not a big deal, these are just like function calls with arguments, from a process perspective, you basically abstract as much as possible from the details of what we sometimes call the navigation of actually executing that test. So open an account might be many more dialogues and many more fields to fill in than the three that I'm showing here. So you can work with default values, and you can click buttons, you can select menu items, you can fill in fields. All of that is hidden under that action open account. And the first big advantage is the readability. You don't have to be a technical person to understand this test. The second advantage is maintenance, because just like with a subroutine, if anything changes in the application under test, you only have to update that single action. And like this deposit action, I'm using it here twice, but I'm implementing it only once. Now an alternative to this approach is BDD, behavior-driven development, which uses natural language statements following a format called a given when, then when. I will talk about that in a moment. That's an alternative way to kind of reach the same effect. And what you try to do here is to make the test easy to read, easy to understand, easy to create for a non-technical person, while at the same time you have a very stable automation. So let's talk about that BDD. In the top part, you see an example of a given when then scenario. So given a customer previously bought a black sweater for me, and I currently have three black sweaters left in stock. When he returns the sweater for a refund, I should have four sweaters in stock. And guess what? That's easy to understand. You don't need to know any details about how that stock, that warehouse is organized. to be able to understand this test. Now what we like to do is take those sentences, convert them into these actions. And so the actual action is like customer buys a sweater, black sweater. Then we set the stock at 3. Then we return that article. And then we check the stock now it should be 4. So what you're seeing here, that the natural language is translated into a slightly more systematic way, which by the way is much easier to manage and to maintain. And to do that, we apply certain rules, customer buys, and then you see the sentence and you see the variable parts, and one action can have actually multiple sentences to it. Now, we created a tool for this to make that translation. It can go from natural language to actions. It can go from actions to natural language. If you are interested in that tool, apart from the rest of our products, I will give it to you. So if you send me an email, I'm happy to give you this tool, and it, whether you can use it with Excel, for example, and you can use it to organize your actions and then have these natural language sentences. So that is about easy to understand of the test. Make the test accessible for as wide an audience as possible. Now let's talk about, on top of this easy to read format, and let's assume for a second that we keep using the actions and the action keywords. Now, that alone is not enough. The fact that the actions are easy to read does not mean that they're already well organized and easy to get an automation flow out of them. For that, you need a bit more. You need a method. Now, the method I will talk about today in the next couple of slides is called action-based testing. It is a modularized method. So it treats tests in modules. We'll see that in a second. And it is completely keyword driven. And I'll talk about that in a few moments as well. It's particularly suited for large and complex projects. And the larger the project, the more important the method becomes. If you have a project with, let's say, 10 test cases, you don't have to worry about anything I'm saying in this webinar. But if you have like hundreds, thousands of test cases, yeah, then you might want to pay attention. Now, you do not necessarily have to follow this method or have to follow exactly the practices that I will talk about, as long as you make it an active effort to think about how you do things, you keep that automation in mind, and you organize it very well. And the method is very agile, even when you use it in a not so agile project. The method is around since about 1994, when we still had waterfall projects. It's almost like a prehistory, but those things happened. And even in that kind of an environment, this method is very flexible. It aims at a high level of automation. We for our own project, have a norm that we try to make at least 95% of tests automated. So I'm not talking about exploratory tests here, but the test that you write down in a test case, in a test management system, in a spreadsheet, anywhere, when you write down, you should try to automate it. And because you automate the keywords, that should be doable. And so what you will see in the approach, now in the webinar, and if you ever read my articles or you get to work with me, you will constantly hear me talk about the importance of test design, much more than I will talk about the technology. Technology can sometimes be important, and it means you have to study it and to work with it, but once it's resolved, it's usually resolved, and you can focus your attention again on the tests. So here is an overview slide, and you should see those test modules like chapters in a book. When you write a book, one of the most difficult things to do is to write a table of contents. It might not be the most time-consuming thing to do, but it is the part that you have to think about the hardest. Once you have that table of contents, so you have organized your thoughts, it's the rest of the book is a lot of work, but as long as you know what you're talking about, it's pretty straightforward to write the book. I know that. I read in the book myself. That's basically how it works. So with tests, it's the same thing. To identify what kind of test you are going to develop, we like to call that the high-level test design. you identify what we like to call test modules. So you identify the pieces that are going to organize your test. I like that to compare that with empty shelves in your home. So let's say you move to a new home and you have closets and you have storage, then the first thing you should do is label that storage. Label the shelves. The paint goes here, the shoes go there, the tools go there. Once you have done that, when the boxes come in with your stuff, to actually put it there might be a lot of work, but as long as you have done the labeling well, it's not that difficult. Same with the test. Once you know this particular test is going to test the financial part, this is customer management, this is about the interaction in a dialogue. Once you have done that, then to actually create those tests when the sprint actually gets there is a relatively straightforward exercise. Now within each test modules we like to have some objectives, natural language statements that detail out the scope of that particular modules, and then one or more test cases, and usually more than one, to actually test those objectives. All of those will use the same set of actions. There is no such thing as a test module specific action. And what the automation is going to do is kind of automate those actions. And if I go back to that book metaphor, automate the words and not automate the test cases. Because once the actions are automated, the test cases should work. Now, in the bottom of the page is something that is of crucial interest, the distinction between what I call interaction test and business test. It will come back in the next couple of slides. An interaction test is really meant to test the interaction, either the human interaction or maybe another system in an API or a service call, but it is really meant for the interaction. So we do things like we enter a username, we enter a password, and then we check whether the OK button is enabled. And it's very detailed, there's not much business logic there. It's really about, can I interact with that system under test. It also means the next step might be remove that username and then check whether the OK button is disabled. So it's really about exercising the interaction. Then separate from that, you have your business test, your functional test, whatever you want to call them. And that is at a higher level of abstraction. And you just do login. So you do not really care how you log in. You just log in. And then you enter a rental agreement and then you check the bill. So if Mary rents a Ford Escape, she has to pay $140. So in a business test, I would not like to see any interaction. So I would not like to see an enter action or a click action or any of that. It should really only be about the business logic. So this is what the test module looks like. And it's in this case when it is in our own tool. We always start with some objectives, just very simple sentences that convince you and anybody else that you're testing the right things here. Then you have some setup, typically start the application and login. Then some test cases where each test case gets set up the preconditions for the next test case. So those test cases form like a narrative, like a story that you tell. And you don't have to do that. You can also make the test cases isolated. But I usually recommend to have a bit of a narrative to exercise that system under test a bit more. And then usually there is a final part where you basically clean up, go back to the home page, close the application, maybe send an email, some other cleaning up that you want to do, reload the database or remove some records that you have created. Stuff like that. Now here are some more techniques that you can use to make the test a little more robust. One of it is that you can actually use variables and expressions. In our tool that looks like this, get the quantity of Chevy Volt that you have. Greater than in our terminology means an assignment. So I'm going to assign that to a placeholder, a variable. Then I rent a car, then I rent another car, and now I should have the original amount minus 2. That pound sign there means it's an expression. And of course you can take any notation that you like, but this is what we do. And by doing that, as long as you make sure you have a lot of volts in your imaginary warehouse, your test is much less dependent on the details of your data. One thing that you can also do, and we'll see that in a moment, you can also go to a programming language and actually assign that variable from the outside. So you could take it from a service call to a REST service, and maybe the temperature of the day, or the Dow Jones index, whatever, you can read it in, put it in a variable, and then the tester can use that variable for the rest of the tests. So by using these placeholders makes the test very versatile. Another practice that we have is what we like to call action definitions. So if you have existing actions like enter and click and check in this case, you can use them to compile a new action which is higher level. And you give it some arguments, in this case customer and amount, and you give it a name, check balance, and once you have done that, you can start reusing that action over and over again in multiple test modules. So we check the balance for Mr. Smith, for Mrs. Jones, for Mrs. James, and we have expected amounts, and we constantly use that same action. Now, what you can also do is you can take this action and put it in yet another action definition for even a higher level action. So this is kind of the equivalent of subroutines, but it's done in a way, even at this level, that a non-technical person can quite easily understand it. And that's of course not true for all actions. Some of these actions are more complicated, like in this case when you want to check the sort order in the table. So you can still go to a programming language, and in our case that is Python, C#, Java, or C++, and just program it there. And we have a convention. We always say action underline and then the name of the action in Camel case. In this case, that is check sort order. Well, we get some arguments, the window name, the table name, the column name. We put that in object variables, table, column, and we get the row count. And then we loop through the rows, and for each row, we get the cell text of that particular column. And then it should be in increasing order. So the moment it goes decreasing, so if current is smaller than previous, and we log in check, that's the administer check call, with the last argument being zero, which means it failed. If we make it to the end of the table, and then we're going to log in pass. So administer check, and the last argument is a one, which means it passed. Now, I'm not saying you have to do it exactly this way, but this is how you can quickly move from that higher level action, or even a lower level action, to the actual programming. In our own product, we have about 381 to be precise, built-in actions. And things like click and select and enter, you don't really have to program that. But if you do it yourself, you can easily imagine you can create this yourself as well, that's not a lot of work to do either. Now what you need to try to do is if you create those new low-level actions, so if you create, you could almost call it built-in actions, like check sort order, try to make it as generic as possible, so that you can use it on any table in any environment. And then our tool, it even means it will work on web, it will work on WPF, it's all very generic. And so you can tap, you have one action as an instrument that you can make any table, check the sort order. Here is a little more advanced trick, if you can say so. I'm just showing it to you to illustrate how you think when you think keywords. In this case, we have a multi-station test. That means in an imaginary bank, we are implementing a teller system, and the teller can pay out money. If you go to the teller window and you say, I want 10,000 euro, then the teller will say, good, but I have to ask my supervisor. So the supervisor is in the back of the office, has her or his own workstation. That supervisor will get a message, will get that transaction and needs to okay it, needs to approve it. So to test that, we need two machines. Can be virtual machines, but they need to play two different roles. And one role is the bank teller, which is withdraw from that account 10,000 euro. We keep the transaction ID in the variable TX. Then the other machine will get active. That is a kind of in a waiting mode. That is the supervisor machine that will approve that particular transaction. Then we go back to the lead machine, and we call that supervisor machine. We call that the deputy machine. Now we go back to the lead machine, and that lead machine is going to continue the test. Now, the reason I'm showing you this is not that you have to literally remember this. I just want to show you that even a complex scenario, if you use these actions, can be made relatively simple to understand and fully automated, of course. And the same is true if you go non-UI. A lot of tests will go for the UI, but other tests might just have an SQL query going into a database, yet other actions might need to do a service call and a REST server, or might have an API that they need to access, OSGI or anything like that. And so all of those actions can be actually in the same test module, and the automation can sort it out. You, as a tester, you don't necessarily have to see that. Now, back to the method level. Here is a test. This is a real test. It comes from a real project. However, I have changed some of the data just to make it a little less recognizable. I don't want to embarrass one of my customers here. But what you see happening is that this test is very detailed and very unfocused. And this is very often what you will get if you ask manual testers to create tests for you. Those manual testers might have a lot of knowledge about what they're testing, but they're not necessarily engineers. So they just follow step by step by step what you're supposed to do something. And what you see here, even though it might be a good test, from an automation perspective, this is very hard to automate. There are way too many checks, checks that do not really fit into the scope of the test. And many checks means very maintenance sensitive. If any of these things that you're checking against changes, you have to go back to all your tests to update. And that's what you want to avoid. That's why you want to use those higher level actions to kind of hide some of that detailed navigation. And that's what I'm constantly saying. If a tester is not on board following a good method, following a good practices, then an automation engineer, not the most clever automation engineer on the planet, can fix that. And you can try to refactor some things like login and some simple actions, which you will never get this right. So how do you do that breakdown? Here are some criteria that you can use. First, the straightforward criteria, that are the criteria that you can always use. And what is the functionality of my system under test? That's usually one of your first questions. Then, how is it built up? Is there a client? Is there a server? Is there a backend application server? Is there a Tomcat server? Whatever it is. What kind of test do I want to do? Negative, positive, and navigation, response times, that stuff. Then, that can be good criteria to organize your test in modules. I will give an example in a moment how that could look like. That could be additional criteria, like which stakeholders are involved. A certain functionality might be for the accounting department or the HR department. The complexity of the test puts difficult tests, like a premium calculation, put it in a separate module so that you can focus on it separately from everything else. Same for if there are specific technical needs, like special hardware, multi-station, like we saw in a second ago. The overall project, the risks, risk-based tests. When you have high risks, you really want to allocate some more tests to that. So identify some more test modules. And of course, smoke tests, but also some more aggressive tests. And you want to separate that because you want the smoke test to work first before you try the more difficult test. Now, last but not least, keep an eye on that business versus interaction. And you really, one of the most common mistakes that I call mistakes that you can make is that you mix interaction with business, so that in the same test module you have business actions and interactionist. I like to call that an anti-pattern. When you see that, you should really be very suspicious because you're taking pretty big risks with the maintainability. I actually recently wrote an article about that in the TechWell site. If you look for my name, you will read can read more of those anti-patterns. So here is how you could do it. First, ask yourself, what are the business objects in my application? What is it about? Is it about cars? Do we have invoices, locations, customers, staff members? What do we have in our system? This is kind of related to object-oriented, but it is not really a development model. It's more like to analyze the business. And then for each business object, look at the life cycle. How can it be created? How can it be accessed? How can it be updated? How can it be closed or deleted? That kind of test. What you will find, again, we're just organizing our test here, that many of the tests that you want to do on an average application can be organized and grouped under the business objects. Then another big category are like the flows, the processes, and the end-to-end workflow style of tests. For example, create an order and then fulfill it, and then the customer pays. You process that that order. You check the journaling in your general ledger. You close the order, stuff like that. And then there could also be a credit invoice. There could also be all kinds of business events that you put in these flows. That's another large portion. And then there is everything else, like administration, user management, technologies. Can the system be customized? Is there interoperability, etc.? So here is that in like a graphic format. So you have a project. In there you have business objects. I gave two examples here, cars and customers. Now within cars, you would make the distinction between the more business-oriented test and the interaction test. So for each of these categories, when you zoom in, you will always have business and interaction coming back again and again and again. I will make these slides available through Test Huddle, and you can also just send me an email about it so you can look at this a little more detailed. Now another question that I often get is, okay, but what about existing tests? I already have 5,000 manual test cases, or I already have 10,000 test scripts. How do I do that? Well, we talked about moving house. That's typically what I would do. I would create the shelves first, figure out what test modules do I need. So you pretend that you start from scratch. So you pretend you don't have any test cases yet. How would I organize them? Then you turn around, look back at the test cases that you actually have, and try to map them into those test modules, where you can really split, in some cases, really split some of those test cases because they have interaction elements and they have business elements. So please put them in separate test modules. And particularly try to avoid what I call overchecking. Only make the checks that fit to the scope of the test. And don't check too much. If a check on an interaction, like a window title, is important, put it in a separate test module, please. And that's what this slide is saying. Always know the scope of the test module. And each test module should have a very clear, understandable scope. It should be preferably different from any other test module. And it should be unambiguous, it should be clear what it is, so that the scope can drive the rest of the test module. And the objectives, the cases, the actions, and most of all, the checks. Now in America we say, keep your eye on the ball. In American football that means that strange looking thing that they call a ball. In Europe we have soccer, football with the round ball, but it is the same idea. When you play soccer, you also need to keep your eye on that ball. So the first and foremost, use the right level of actions. And when you look at this particular little sequence of two actions, it is, in most cases, this will be too detailed. If you're only interested in a business functionality, like is there a check task in this project, and the task plan of approach needs to be in the drill assembly project, then please say so. And don't do a click tree item, checklist item exist. Let's assume that you have hundreds of those tests, and suddenly the tree structure changes. So the projects is changed to programs, or maybe the tree is replaced with a list box. You have to go back in all your tests to maintain that. But you can also go the opposite way and make a mistake that you are too detailed. Not detailed enough. Like here I say, check invalid user ID password, but it's not very clear to me, looking at this line, what am I actually checking? Having a look at this line, it's not very clear. There's a password going on and an old password going on, and it's not clear what we're actually checking here. And that's also wrong. It should be clear what you're checking when you look at the test module. It should not be necessary to look in the action to see the details of the test. Now we talked about test design. Let's focus on the automation side for a moment, the technology. And there's a couple of things that you should do. First of all, test your automation. You create actions, you create interface mappings, make sure they work before you let testers work with them, and before you run tests with them. Make sure that you identify properties of UI elements. I will talk about that in a moment. And make sure that your timing is active, so avoid fixed sleeps. You should never have in your test sleep for 5 seconds for the UI to come ready, especially a virtual machine. That can be a very big problem. Make sure that your system design is automation friendly. We'll talk about that in a moment. And keep an eye on the test design. That is still the test design that defines like 90% of how successful your automation is going to be. Here you see an example about that interface mapping. And we always like to call our controls interface elements, and whether it's an HTML element or a WPF control. But what you see here is we have a bunch of text boxes here, and that you can either label with a field, with a label, or you can have a position. But that is quite maintenance sensitive. If you have a Spanish version of the system in the test, those labels are going to be different. If you put it in a certain order, like 4, 5, or 6, if there is a new text box, it's going to be dependent. So why don't we go ahead and just take an hidden property, like in this case the accessible name, which is a hidden property. A user can't see that, but a test tool can. So you label that control with that property. And that means that property can be kept stable. So even though the UI might be in another language, the property itself can stay the same, and that makes your automation a lot more stable. And then you get something like this, and whether it's an automation ID property that you specifically created for this purpose, or you just use a name property or accessible name or ID in a web page, anything will do as long as it is stable. So here are some of those key items for what we like to call testability. And first of all, testability of the system and the test should be a must-have requirement. So as a team, as an organization, as a company, you need to agree that testability is important, and that it is at least as important as some of the functionalities of the system and the test. We already talked about identifying properties. That's the very first thing you need to do, which will speed up your automation enormously in your sprint. So that should be part of your sprint, should be communication between developers and testers about what are going to be the hidden properties for my elements. Now, we already said to avoid hard sleeps at all costs. That means if it is not obvious what you can wait for, then the developer needs to help you find something to wait for, an API call or an inherited property or anything like that. Also, anything else that is visible on the screen that is interesting for the tester should be accessible, if not through the screen, through a white box internal call. And be careful about security that hackers don't get these calls. But other than that, it should be visible. And like if you have a game with monsters, it should be possible to find out where the monsters are without any having to kind of interpret the image process the images in the game. And of course, last but not least, design your test system well. That's something in a modern project will do anyway, but having a well-defined system will also help in well-defined tests and well-defined automation. So let me show you what that can look like. Here is what it could look like in an agile project. So you have a number of sprints, and in each sprint you basically take your product backlog for that sprint, your sprint backlog, but you also look at the tests. And hopefully you have done some high-level test design, again empty shelves. You can refine that further in the sprint, but you have an idea what kind of tests you're going to need and what how they should be organized. And then what you need to do, start at the beginning of the sprint, be part of the PO discussions and the product ownership discussions, and start creating tests. And try to create those tests at the same level of abstract as the user stories. And because the sprint is still at the beginning phase, it will force you to be high level. It will avoid that you're going to be too low level with your steps, because you simply don't know what that low level is like yet. That's only going to come later in the sprint. Now, your interface definition should be easy if you cooperate with your developers. And when you say you have an OK button, what are you going to call it? Developer will say, let's call it OK button. And then you say, oh, that sounds good. And then you can just put it in your interface definition. That also means that you're not going to use any interface viewer or spy tool or anything. You can just do it manually. And you all do that early in the sprint. Then when the sprint moves on, you can gradually start automating the actions. Remember, we're not automating test cases, we're automating actions. And when you have done that interface definition well, you can simply record those actions. That will go very smooth. And then once you can also start creating some interaction tests, and you see there at the bottom, I like to talk about the main test modules, the interaction test modules, and then for interoperability, crossover modules to other parts of the system. And gradually start filling in those links. Now, by the time you're done, and where I generally prefer to have a three-week sprint rather than a two-week sprint, but even in a two-week sprint, by the time you get done, you should be able to have most of the tests developed and running. And then, if that is successful, then you can take those tests, but also those actions, and reuse them in the next sprint. And whatever you try to do, try to stay in sync. Try to keep those tests and that automation in sync with the rest of the team. So to do that, you need some preconditions. And first of all, you need to agree on the approach. When you start a new method in a sprint team, it will take a while for that sprint team to get used to it. You might have to discuss some of these items, and you might not always agree, and you might not agree that you do it this way. It doesn't even matter, but make sure that you all agree, testers, product owners, developers, that you all agree how you're going to do this and how important testability is and all that. Of course, you need to know, as a tester, you need to know what you're testing. So when there are certain test modules that you're going to build during the sprint, do you understand what's going in there? Do you have enough understanding of the subject matter that you can create them? And by asking questions, you can help everybody in the team understand it better. And of course, you know your testing theory. You need to know a bit about automation. If you use a method like action-based testing or test frame, you need to be aware of that. Best practices like avoid anti-patterns. Any automation technology should be a given. It should not be that in the middle of the sprint you find out that you don't know how to do an API call. that should be done. You should also have an idea what to do with data. I have no time for that today, but I've written an article about it, so look at my Happy Tester site, you can find it. And there I tell how to deal with data and test data. Now, one thing that I have good experience with is what I like to call sit-down meetings. Normally in a sprint, you have your morning stand-up meetings in which you just say what you did yesterday, what you're going to do today, and what any impediments are. That's a quick stand-up meeting. At the end of the day, you're tired, sit down, drink some tea, and talk about what you did during the day. How did it go? So that's the focus is not on the work to be done, but the focus in the method. And what I found is if you do it that way, you are more relaxed, and you have preferably somebody who is experienced, so some kind of a moderator, I play that role myself sometimes, who is knowledgeable, you can very quickly learn a couple of those sessions, and you're basically already good to go. This works better than, for example, a retrospective, because you already forgot quite a bit of what you were working on. But again, just look for it yourself. Now, one other thing you can do is that you actually help the sprint teams from outside of the sprints. And one of the ways to do that is that you have an organization, a facility. It could be external, and this is a large part of our own business, but it could also be internal, that you have people around that can pick up where you left off so that the QA still owns it, but can move on to the next sprint and start making tests, develop test automation for the next sprint. Well, the backup team, the B team, takes care of the additional tests that might need to be made. Maybe those tests need to be executed against a multitude of platforms, virtual machines, all that stuff. Maybe some DevOps stuff that needs to happen that you do not really want to do in the sprint. So just clean it up, the cleaning crew. And again, we do that a lot, but you can do that, organize that yourself quite nicely. Okay, this is where I want to keep it for now. If you go to my Happy Tester website or my logicgear.com, you can read a lot more. That might answer a lot of questions you might come up with in the coming days. Here is a summary. The primary goal, as far as I'm concerned in a sprint project that is doing automated testing, is to keep up with the crowd, keep up with the team. The QA should not lag behind. Test design, for me, is the key driver. That's 80 to 90% of the success. However, testability of the application and the test can be of crucial importance as well. Depends a bit on what system it is. Organize it very well. Agree on how you organize it. You do not have to do it the way I was showing you, but find some way to make this work. And how much of that you want to get done in the double quote, or how much you want to do somewhere else. And maybe have some organization to back up, even if it's nothing else than just fix technical impediments or fix test data, anything like that. Okay, with that I would give it back to you, Derek.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that presentation, Hans. I'll just open my screen here again very briefly and just go through one or two more slides. And we have a number of webinars as well taking place next month. Here are three that we have lined up so far. We have a webinar on Scrum in Hardware with Marcus Gardner. We have a webinar with Dirk-Jan de Groot and Jan-Jaap Kannegetter on survival techniques for testers. And we also have a webinar on understanding cultural dimensions in linguistic testing with Ifrad Hamid and Rajini Padmanabhan. And also, right now, up until the end of May, you can avail of a 15% discount on your registration for the EuroSTAR conference. So just head over to the site there and you can avail of this discount and check out all the different talks that are taking place. And one question that has popped up quite a bit there is that, is this webinar being recorded? And the answer is yes, we record all of our webinars. I'll share a link with you here now. And This is where you'll find our webinars. If you want to check back, I know there was a lot of information there from Hans, so you can check back there and I'll add that very shortly. So we're almost out of time, so I'll just go through a couple of questions here. I have a question for you, Hans, that's asking, which says, in our development environment, we have developed our own Scrum method where we are encouraged to have fewer meetings. Do you find that sit-down meetings take away from valuable development and testing time?
No, I don't think so, but that's a personal experience. I find that you only need a few of those meetings and they don't take very long. Remember, you're trying something new. If you already know what you're doing, if it's not new to you, you don't have to have those sit-down meetings. But I rather do it when the iron is hot, the same day, then I wait for a retrospective, because retrospective also costs time. And when you're already kind of, let's say, on the wrong path, then that takes a lot more time to get back in the right path, if there is such a thing as a wrong and a right path. So that would be my answer. Try it yourself. It really depends on the team.
The next question here is asking, how much UI testing should be done? Shouldn't the effort be on API level?
Well, you probably all know that the testing at API level has some distinct advantages. It's usually easier to automate. The automation tends to be simpler and more maintainable, more stable. It also tends to be faster. And when you have a well-organized system under test, you should be able to do a lot of the test for other means of the UI. That's sometimes called the test pyramid. However, UIs also have a tendency to become more complex, either in client-server systems, but also in web-based systems. And we probably all know the SPA, the single-page application with AngularJS, those can also be quite complicated. So the answer is, like for many questions, it depends. It depends on circumstances. And that high-level test design I was talking about can help you make up your mind about questions like that as well.
Okay, we're almost out of time, so I'll take one more question here. And this attendee is asking, says, I noticed end-to-end tests were mentioned. One of the points of automation is don't include dependencies in the tests unless it is those dependencies you want to test. Are end-to-end tests valuable to automation, or do they provide the same coverage as smaller functional tests?
Well, again, that depends on your test design. Usually, end-to-end tests are better for testing the process and the business logic. The lower level test, the more detailed test, I would put in separate test modules. And that's the whole point of these test modules, is that you can answer questions like that. What do I do at a higher level? What do I do at a lower level? Now, needless to say, if you do end-to-end tests, keep them at a high level of abstraction. Otherwise, they're going to be very dependent. The question already says so. They become very dependent on your system and the test. And that's what you do not want. So that's what actions are for.
Okay, I think we're going to have to wrap it up there now. We've gone over time just slightly. I'd like to thank today's presenter, Hans Buelda, for taking time out. I know it's very early where you are there now, so I won't keep you for too long, but thank you very much. And thank you to all of our attendees today and all of your questions. That's the end of our May webinar series, but as I mentioned, we have a number of great webinars lined up for June so far, and we have some more great ones in the pipeline, which I will let you know about down the line. And I'll share a link with you as well to the webinar schedule so you can go have a look. That's it from us today. Thank you all and take care.
Yeah, bye-bye.